Heavenly Father, O Lord, we come before thee again. Thou art God over all. Thou art our Heavenly Father, and we come before thee, for thou art great. Thou art the Holy One. Thou art majestic. Thou art the gracious God, the merciful God, the one who has provided the only way of salvation through the grace of our dear Savior and Redeemer, the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us. So Lord, we come on this special occasion, trusting in thee, but also with great anticipation and expectation that thou will bless us. O Lord, deal tenderly with us. We pray that thou will forgive us again, forgive all our sins, wash us clean, purify us from all our transgressions. We pray that in our thoughts, in our praises, in our words, in the preaching of thy word, as we gather together, we pray that Christ will be lifted up. O Lord, we are so indebted. We owe to thee all things. We are nothing without thee. So we cry again that the gracious Holy Spirit will enlighten thy word unto our hearts, to open our eyes so that we can contemplate and behold the wondrous things from thy word. Lord, we thank thee for this sufficient word, and we pray that it will govern us, it will guide us, it will instruct us and admonish us, and also give us that great hope, that lively hope, that we know Christ is with us and he is dealing with us, with each one of us standing. O Lord, please move in the midst of thy people. We pray that our thoughts will be so focused on our dear Savior that all things will just be vanity before us. So Lord, bless us again and accept our adoration as we pray and ask all these mercies in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. But fornication and all uncleanness and all covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints, neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them. For ye are sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light. For whatsoever doth make manifest is light. Wherefore he said, awake, thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Yes, sir. Blessed to our hearts today. Let's sing together our second hymn, number 119, version 8. Hymn number 119, version 8. Oh, how I love thy holy word, thy gracious covenant, Lord.
Thank you. Bible study, and to welcome also those who join us on live webcast. The preacher this evening is Pastor Ibrahim Mohammed, our assistant pastor. Please stay if you can for fellowship and refreshments at the close of the meeting. Recordings of this evening's message will be available. Our Sovereign Trial magazine can be obtained, and our bookshop will be open. And other audio and video recordings of recent ministry are available, including from last Sunday with the gospel message from Luke 16, verse 11, false and true riches. This coming Sunday, our teaching service is at 11 in the morning, and the preacher will be our pastor, Dr. Peter Masters, and the ministry will be from Luke 4, verse 1, the temptation of Christ. And this coming Sunday evening, 6:30, is our evangelistic service, and the preacher will be Pastor Ibrahim. Now, let's again join in prayer together. Our gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we praise Thee and we thank Thee for this opportunity to gather. Midweek, we think of every providence, which means that we can be here this night, gathered in this way, all the way Thou hast been with us, all the provision Thou hast shown to us, and we thank Thee we can come, for Thou hast drawn us to Thee in the Lord Jesus Christ, our dear Saviour. And we come to Thee in His name, and we praise Thee, and we thank Thee afresh for salvation in Christ. Oh Lord, we marvel at His amazing love toward us. We praise Thee and thank Thee for pardon from sin, for new spiritual life. We praise and thank Thee, O Lord, for adoption into the family of our gracious God and our loving Heavenly Father. We praise Thee and thank Thee, O Lord, for the indwelling work and power of the gracious Holy Spirit. And we look to Thee and we praise Thee, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the God of our salvation, the God of our hope, the true and living God. And we bow before Thee and we worship Thee, O Lord, Thou art mighty beyond our imagination. Thou art altogether wonderful, perfect and pure and holy, just and righteous. And we come, O Lord, before Thee, knowing Thou to see us through and through. And we pray, looking to Thee, O Lord, for Thy mercy and Thy loving kindness afresh in the Lord Jesus Christ, our dear Saviour. And pray Thou wilt receive us in Him and pardon and bless us and be with us and deal with us now. Lord, Lord, we pray that Thou wilt help us to live day by day for Thee. Oh, gracious God, as we confront and struggle with sin. Oh, Lord, as we seek that zeal we need for Thy service, as we seek, oh, Lord, that compassion and courage for witness. Oh, gracious God, remind us, we pray, of our calling. Remind us, we pray, of the love of Christ and the fatherhood of our gracious God, and the indwelling of the Spirit, and our eternal glorious future. And, oh Lord, by these things we pray. Oh Lord, stir us up and hold us and keep us close to Thee, we pray, and help us, we pray, to live for Thee and to serve Thee. And, oh Lord, we do pray, Thou wilt bless our witness as individuals. Grant us opportunity, we pray, in every place where Thou dost set us, to speak for Christ. And we bring to Thee all our witness as a fellowship of Thy people in this place, as we go out into this community. Oh Lord, by various means, we pray Thou wilt be with us. We pray Thou wilt grant us words to speak. We pray Thou wilt have mercy upon many and bring them into this place under the sound of Thy word. And oh Lord, we thank and praise Thee for the ministry of Thy word that Thou dost give us here. Oh Lord, look upon us, we pray tonight. Enable Thy servant and open Thy word to us and speak to us, we pray, and build us up in our most holy faith. And oh Lord, we look to Thee for Sunday as we gather together. Bless Thy servants, we pray, in the ministry of Thy word. Draw many, many into this place. Oh Lord, come, we pray, and speak to us and change our lives and grant us progress in spiritual things. And oh Lord, we pray, bring in the unsaved, bring in the seekers, bring in those, oh Lord, even mindless spiritual things, and be with us, we pray, in the preaching of the gospel. and reach, O Lord, we pray, and save needy souls. And, O Lord, how we thank thee for the great ministry thou hast given us to children and young people here and in the branch Sunday schools. O Lord, we pray for thy continued blessing, and that thou yet have mercy upon men and save them while they are yet young. We think of that relatively new outreach in Brixton and continue to pray, O Lord, for thy blessing on all the visitation, and that thou grant increase in numbers there and a mighty testimony in that place. O Lord, we bring to thee our Sunday school winter party this Saturday and look to thee, gracious God, for safety and enabling and blessing, a time of enjoyment for the children, a time of encouragement for them to continue to come under the sound of thy word. And, O gracious God, we do pray for those of our number who are unwell, for old and young alike, that thou wilt be pleased to bless them, gracious God, and grant them, we pray, recovery, if it please thee. We think particularly of our aged sister, so very unwell at this time, O Lord. Comfort her and bless her, we pray. May we all, in all our circumstances, have cause to give thee praise and thanks, and give to thy people, we pray, a great testimony, even in their adversity. And, O Lord, we would pray for those of thy people who are persecuted in so many places. O Lord, we would, according to the exhortation of thy word, pray with those, for those who are bound as if bound with them, and yet we can scarcely imagine the circumstances of so many shut away in prison camps, so many suffering such deprivation, tens of hundreds of thousands of thy people under totalitarian regimes, under religious oppression. O Lord our God, we pray that thou wilt be pleased to bless and comfort thy persecuted people and draw near to them. If it please thee, ease their burdens. If it please, we pray, grant liberty to many. And, O Lord, these days remind us that we look unto thee for the coming of our dear Saviour. We look to that day, and we pray, come, Lord Jesus, and bring to an end these persecutions, and take the glory to thyself. O Lord, so we look to thee again this night. We pray thou wilt be with us and bless us from thy word. We pray thou wilt bless our fellowship together. Gracious God, we ask all these mercies with great thanksgiving in our Lord Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. And verse 16, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. So my subject tonight is every opportunity counts. Every opportunity given to you and me by the Lord counts. It's important. I wouldn't go at length in any background or introduction to this verse, but you can see how the Christian life is illustrated or pictured as a walk many times throughout the Bible, but especially in Paul's letter to the Ephesians. The Christian life is compared to a walk. That's the metaphor, a beautiful metaphor. And at least seven times in Ephesians, you find that word walk, to walk, to walk. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 and 2, we have our past walk. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, we have our compassionate and fruitful walk. The Christian is saved to do good works. And in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, you find our vocational walk. We are called to walk a walk that is worthy of our vocation, that great calling given to us by the Lord Jesus Christ. Then, still in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17, these are basic things, actually. Even if you do a quick glance through Ephesians, you will find that. And as I said in chapter 4, verse 17, twice we have the differential walk of the Christian. We walk in a different way than the non-believers, than the Gentiles. We were there in the past, but that's not the way we walk now. Then, when you come to Ephesians chapter 5 now, three times you find chapter 5, verse 2, walk in love. A Christian is someone who walks in love. He loves the Lord. He loves earnestly and sincerely the brethren, but he loves also his neighbor. He wants to witness to his neighbor. He wants to pray for his neighbor. He is concerned for other people. And then in chapter 5, verse 8, we read it. For you were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. Children of light. Before we were darkness, we did things in darkness, in a gloomy way, in a secret way. But now, because God is light, we are children of light, so we have to be imitators of our Father. And then in verse 15, you find actually the seventh one, seventh mention of the Christian walk here. In verse 15, see then that you walk circumspectly. What does that mean? It's a Latin word, actually. It means you can sense the word circumference in the word. We don't use it quite often nowadays, but it means look around, look all around. Don't look in circle, in a vicious circle, but while you are walking, every dimension, every part, every parameter, every aspect, you should be watchful. So be watchful. That's the meaning also. Look all around. Walk carefully, walk precisely, walk exactly, walk accurately, walk attentively, but also walk diligently. All those aspects are actually in the word circumspectly there. My dear brothers and sisters, we have to think before we act. That's the meaning. We have to walk with caution. Why? Because there are many, many dangers that lay in ambush before you and ahead of you. The devil is very crafty, he's very cunning. Many ambushes. So the Christian has to walk circumspectly, carefully, attentively, exactly. And do not be impulsive. That's also another meaning of that word. My dear brothers and sisters, we have to study the Christian life carefully, thoroughly. Why? Because the Christian life is not a game. We have to take it very seriously as we walk with the Lord, as we walk with one another, and as we walk with non-believers. Why this is so important? I'm sure you know that. The people of the world are judging the Lord, the Christian church, and Christians by the way we walk. By the way we walk. They judge the Lord. Oh, is he a savior? Look how his people walk. Look how the church behaves. So we have to walk circumspectly, Paul says. So study carefully the Christian life. Salvation turns a fool into a wise man. That's what the Bible says. I was a foolish man, living for myself, self-centered, self-adulating, self-indulging myself. But then salvation comes. Bible says the scriptures are able to make you wise unto salvation. So the foolish man who said before, there is even no God, I'm just living for himself, for the here and now, there is a transformation, a radical and drastic transformation in his life. He doesn't live anymore for himself. He lives now for the Lord. He has a purpose in life. So we are to walk in wisdom. Why am I mentioning this? Paul mentions it in verse 15. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. Wisdom is related to the way we walk. But also Paul adds now, as we come to verse 16, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Wisdom, the simplest definition of wisdom, we have given it many times behind this pulpit. Wisdom is knowledge applied spiritually, sacredly. It's not about being skilled or being ingenious or even having a string of many titles, academic titles. That's not wisdom. And wisdom also, because in some places, because somebody is old, he's 60, 70, he's wise. Wisdom has nothing to do with academics. It has nothing to do with age. It has to do with knowledge applied spiritually. So the wise man, who is the wise man? The wise man, Proverbs 1, verse 7, the fear of the Lord is just the beginning of wisdom, but the wise man is the person who walks circumspectly, redeeming the time, and you can see the connection now with wisdom and time. They are closely related. You cannot separate them. You walk as a Christian, God makes you to be wise with knowledge applied spiritually, and that knowledge applied spiritually now makes you also to take into account the time God has given you. So they are interconnected. And why I'm spending time on this one verse, verse 16, because twice it is mentioned in the Word of God. And this is a rudiment explanation when we do Bible interpretation. When something is mentioned twice, thrice, four times, then it means it's very important. We come to this verse because we haven't dealt with it in Colossians chapter 4, verse 5. The same, you find the same admonition, the same exhortation. Paul says in Colossians 4, verse 5, redeeming the time. And here he says also, redeeming the time because the days are evil. So now I would like really to, a lot of things will be said, as you know, but I want to make it practical, really practical. Hopefully you leave this place saying to myself, I must do something. I must really bear in mind this great command given to me by the Lord Jesus Christ tonight. So three headings, 3 points if you prefer. The first one, is that word, the redeeming. What does it mean? The second, the time. And the third one, the stimulus, or if you prefer, the reason, and the why we need to redeem the time. So without any further ado, look at the first aspect, the first heading. Redeeming, that word. And I'm sure you know, this is a doctrinal, theological, it's a precious word, really. It is related to salvation. Why? It is a beautiful and precious word. You know that. To whom is it related? The Lord Jesus Christ is our Redeemer. The Lord Jesus Christ redeemed us by and with his precious blood. No other blood is sufficient. No other blood is salvific. Only the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And now we are invited, we are exhorted Please, it's not optional. It's not because it is in the present tense continuous that it is optional. Or if I feel like, no, the redeeming here is a command. It is compulsory to every child of God. And what does it mean? Christ redeemed us by his precious blood. We are also to redeem the time. Being bought back from our vain life, or the vain life we have inherited from even our forefathers. That's in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18, 19. We read it many times. That vain life of the past, we have been redeemed from that. We are wasting time. We are just living for the here and now, not thinking about heaven, not thinking about serving the Lord, not giving homage to the one who has saved us. But as we read the word of God now, we have been brought up. It's our turn also to buy up time, to redeem the time. And so my first question to you tonight, redeeming the time, is there someone you are really burdened about tonight? Someone from your family, at work or at uni, in the neighborhood, in the community, someone you are burdened about to concern for. Concern not just for his well-being. Yes, we want to pray for people to be healed, but the greatest healing, the greatest liberation, the greatest freedom is to have my sins forgiven. So that's why we are concerned for people, not just to be compassionate to them, providing physical needs, but the spiritual need that's greater than anything else. So are you burdened for anyone? Buy up the time. Make use of the best opportunity given to you. A word in season may change his life. Buy him up and set him free. Set him free from the dominion of sin, from the power of sin, and Satan also, and self. We can redeem. Actually, that's the picture behind the word redeem. Here is someone sold to the devil. He's just living for himself. But what must I do as a believer? I want to preach the gospel to him. And I'm sure everyone in this congregation knows that the gospel means good news. Good news from heaven. Good news to the sinners. They can be set free. And now they can have fellowship with the living God. God becomes their father. They can pray to him. They are adopted in his family. And your name will never be erased from the Lamb Book of Life. That's assurance. It is assurance. And I can tell you from experience that the Christian religion is the only one which has a Savior and the only one which gives us that assurance. Only the Lord Jesus Christ, as we repent and trust in him. So that's the first thing. If you ask me what is the meaning of redeeming, it means buy back, buy up that time. But it is also a market word, marketplace word. That's the meaning of redeeming. It is related to slaves in New Testament times. And you know this, I'm sure. When there are sales in shops, what do people do? They are ready to go there. So the same idea, it's a marketplace word, meaning as soon as you enter in some shops, if I can just give you a personal insight here. Most of the time when I enter in a shop and the person, the seller asks me, can I help you? I feel embarrassed and I want to leave. But the idea, that person, that seller is redeeming the time. Well done, because she wants, or better than Black Fridays or whatever you may put there, the idea is the seller is redeeming the time, making the best of the occasion. And I know nothing about farming, but the same idea comes there. The farmer must know exactly when to sow his seed. The farmer must know exactly when it's time for harvest. He's redeeming the time. So you can apply it to different ways in life as you understand the word redeeming. So time is to be redeemed. It is not a help yourself commodity, not just there to take. You have to pray about it and take initiatives about it. My dear brothers and sisters, we have to pray for opportunities that day after day, God will give us opportunities to redeem the time, to speak to someone for whom we are burdened, as I said earlier, for whom we want to see coming to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. But now, if you are not a believer, if you have never sought and found the Lord, the kindest word, I'm underlying that word kindness, the kindest word I can tell you tonight, you are wasting your time. You are not redeeming your time. Why? In Bible pictures, somebody who is not converted, who doesn't know the Lord Jesus Christ, and forgive me if you don't like my picture here, he is like an animal in a dungeon, a wild animal in a cage. What is he doing? Turning in circles, in vicious circles, not knowing where he's going. Because only the believer can redeem the time. That word can only be applied to a believer. And Paul, who is writing from Ephesians, I'm sure you know that, Paul was in prison. You may say, is that a place where someone could redeem the time? But guess what? Paul was not a wild animal in a dungeon. He was praying. He was witnessing. He was writing Ephesians, Colossians, Philippians, Philemon, 2 Timothy. All these letters were written while he was in prison. So he was redeeming the time. The redeeming of the time means that we have to do wholesome things, to pray, to read the scriptures, to examine our hearts, to witness to non-believers, to worship the Lord, to serve him with all our hearts, but also to attend services where believers meet, but also to visit one another. So, to redeem the time is to look around, to test all things. There are bargains. There are bargains every day in this life. What do we do? The commercials, they know that well. That's why they give us many bargains. And you will see people queuing. I don't know, maybe I'm exaggerating here. They queue, they don't sleep at home that night when they know there are bargains. They will sleep in front of the shop. They are redeeming the time. That's the picture. So there are many bargains given to us. We have to take them. But please, my dear brothers and sisters, I hope no one will misunderstand me here. When we speak about redeeming the time, we are not speaking about being task-driven people. We are not speaking about being business-oriented people. That's not what I mean, because you can be task-oriented, you can be very busy in life and achieve nothing. There are people who are busy, busy, they are always busy, but the product, the outcome is nothing. Oh, what a vanity, that's very bad. That's why, you know, the acronym for the word busy in the wrong way, busy is being under Satan's yoke. That's the way you have to look at it. If you are not busy for the Lord, Martin Luther, he said, if you are not busy for the Lord, you are not busy at all. So our busyness here is in things related not just to ourselves, but mainly to the Lord. We should be like Mary. In Luke chapter 10, verse 42, it is said that Christ actually spoke there. Please never throw the stone on Martha. I heard preachers saying, oh, Martha, you are busy. But the problem with Martha, she was doing the right thing at the wrong time. But Mary now, she was doing the right thing at the right time, to be at the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why she was told, Christ said, Mary has the one thing needed. And Mary has taken that thing which is needed, and she has taken the best part, which will never be taken away from her. So, busyness, good, but it must be in the right direction. And please, don't be just task-oriented. We are people-oriented. We love people. That's the use of the time. Otherwise, we will just be turning in circles again and being active activists without any fruit, without any result. So redeem the time. And so many irrelevant trifles absorb our time. Please avoid them. Avoid those things which captivate you, and make a sacred use of time. Be heavenly minded. But I must move on. The second thing, after the redeeming, the first says, redeeming what? The time. The time. My dear brothers and sisters, I'm sure you know that. The Bible begins with time, Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, and ends with time. Revelation 22, verse 20. Christ said, I'm coming soon. Soon is time. So Bible begins with time and ends with time. Now, time is precious. We know that. Time is precious. You know why time is a raw gold? Why time is a treasure? Because it is short. Even if you are 70, you are 80, you are 90, just a few days. I was amazed because not long time ago, in October, we celebrated the 500th year of the Reformation. I thought it was like yesterday. Really? Why? Time is short. No matter how you prolongate it or elongate it, no matter how you take it, real longevity you have, as you look at it, time is very short. It is short. So that's why Bible invites us to make the best use of it. It is short because days are also short, the days that are given to us. Every tick of the clock is a reminder that time is short. Time is limited. It flies inexorably and full of trouble. We are like grass, like a vapor, a puff of smoke, a cloud that soon passes. God gave birth to time, you know that. Because God lives outside space and he lives outside time. God doesn't need time. This is my simple way of explaining time. Time is for God to show us his love. That's why he created time. Otherwise, he doesn't need it. He doesn't need it. So time is his gracious gift for our human race. But also, this is how I look at it. Time is like a bracket, a parenthesis. That parenthesis has been opened from the beginning when God created the heavens and the earth. But guess what? One day, that bracket is going to be closed and there will be no more time. We will enter into eternity. No more time, no more pain, no more sicknesses, no more tears, no more death. Only life in company with the Lord Jesus Christ. So time is a bracket given to us by the Lord Jesus Christ. Because as Galatians 4:4 says, in the fullness of time, at the appointed time, God sent his son, born of a virgin under the law. Why? For us to be children of the living God, to be adopted in the family of God. So time is precious. You can see there is something beneficial that God has done in due time, in the appointed time, and it is a gift for him to us. So that's why we have to make the best of it. And since the fall, time is against us. A Christian doesn't kill time. You hear people wandering around just killing time. No. A Christian doesn't blow up time. That is not even a murder. It is a suicide. Somebody who is killing time, just misusing time, he will give account before God. Now, I have to explain the word time here because it has really a profound meaning. Now, the word time, there are two Greek words used in the Bible to specify or to speak about time. The one used here is not about duration. The duration word is the word we have in English, in French, and in many other languages, chronology. That's not the word used here. The word we have here, as I said, is not about duration. But it is about the quality time, not the quantity. It is about the set time, the opportune time given to us by God to fulfill his purposes. And remember, can I apply Romans 8:28 here? All things work for good. All things, time the Satan given to us by God. So we are to exhorted here to make the best use of our time for something substantial, something solid, edifying, and giving glory to God. My dear brothers and sisters, I often say this to myself. I was converted, I found the Lord when I was 22, and sometimes I weep, I said I wasted a lot of time prior to my conversion. We have wasted a lot of time before knowing, coming to the Lord Jesus Christ. So no more time to waste. No more time to waste. So time is so precious. And I believe the richest man in the world is the time redeemer. The devil wants to absorb us by useless things. Oh, how fit is Psalm 90. You know the passage. Moses said, God, oh Lord, teach us to number our days so that we can apply our hearts unto wisdom. You see again the relationship between wisdom and time? The two are interconnected. So if you are a wise man or a wise woman, the way you use your time will tell. And better use it wisely. And when you became a believer, it is as if you have sold yourself and your time to the Lord. Some people say, oh, I only give to the Lord 1 hour a week. 1 hour a week? And you say you love the Lord Jesus Christ? But you have sold yourself to the Lord already. He doesn't need a tip. Some people, they are giving a tip to the Lord. Lord, just a day a week is enough for you. And actually, not even a day a week, just one service a week is enough for you. That's what you deserve. And the rest is for whom? Oh, the rest is for me. It's for my family. It's for my work. It's for my pleasures. It's for my leisures, and so on. People are just amused nowadays. No more amazement. We should be amazed, not just amused about it. Awesome things are happening. So we are to be the ones who are redeeming the time. All our time is to the Lord Jesus Christ by right. We are all full-time ministers in the Lord's service. Only what is done for the Lord will last for you. Your money, your work, your car, your house, you will leave it here. But only what is done for the Lord will last forever. You take it with you. Our works will follow us. We read in the book of Revelation. So relationship can be restored. Grades, your exam grades can be regained. You can redo your exam. But time that is misused will never be regained. You can turn back your clock or your watch, but you cannot turn back the time. It's gone, and it is gone forever. And no time for God. Oh, what a fool, the person who says he has no time for God. So the way we use our time affects our spiritual life. Some people say, oh, I'm too busy. I haven't read the Bible. I cannot read the Bible. I'm too busy. I don't pray because I'm too busy. Busy doing what? This is essential. Can I quote to you again? You heard me many times. Matthew 6, verse 33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, Bible says. So, no time to read, no time to attend services, no time to pray, no time to call someone to encourage him, no time to witness, then we are misusing our time. If you don't redeem the time, time will go against you and become your worst enemy on time. Now thirdly, we explained the redeeming part, we explained the time part, but now the reason, why should we redeem the time, the stimulus? Why, what is the reason? The reason is given to us. Redeeming the time, why? Because the days are evil. I don't know if there is a humanist here. Okay, if you are here, the humanist is saying and believing this world is going to get better and better. Better and better. Oh, what a wonderful world, they sing. Oh, Bible says, no, what a sad world. What a sad world. Why? The days are evil. The days are evil. Time is not evil, but the world in which we live is evil. It's polluted. It is contaminated. It is anti-God. There is great antagonism against the living God. It is a reality. Time is good, but this world is evil. And the word evil, the pastor explained it to us when he was dealing with 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. The word evil there, it's not about being intrinsically bad and corrupt and morally evil. That's not the meaning here. The meaning of the word evil here, it means damaging, harming. The days are harming. The days are damaging. We live in a broken world. We are broken people. We are all depressed in one way or the other. Why? Because of sin within us. You see, every day is filled with the deceitfulness of man's heart. The lion, the old serpent, the dragon has not yet stopped walking around and roaring, seeking whom to devour us, as 1 Peter tells us. The devil has not stopped yet working. So we need to remember that the days are evil and the churches have been invaded by the world instead of influencing the world. Oh, days are evil. People worship themselves. We live, let me call it the me-ism generation. Me, just me. And no one else. My opinion, my thoughts, my ideas, my imagination. It's all utopia, actually. But people think this is great. Things that have never heard before, have never happened before, are happening nowadays. The other day, a brother was telling me, you know the latest news? Someone marrying himself, going to the town hall. Who is your spouse? Who is the groom? Who is the bride? I'm the groom, I'm the bride. I signed for myself. Never heard of it. Three men being in marriage together. Never heard of that before. Am I inventing those things? The days are evil. But guess what? If the days are evil in Paul's time, you remember what brought the flood? Genesis chapter 6, verse 6, 7, and 8. What brought the flood? The heart of man was wicked. So the flood came. And Paul is telling us the days are evil 2,000 years ago. What are they now? More than evil, damaging, harming. That's what they are. How do we know? Opportunities are fading away. You know that. Doors are closing. I was told in the past, in this nation, even in this great city, before children enter in a classroom at school, they pray, they read the Bible. There are schools now, it is forbidden. Most schools are coming. Maybe one, just few exceptions. Open air preaching is forbidden in so many places. So the days are evil. We have to bear that in mind. Unmatched hatred against the gospel. Unbelief is rampant. So please forgive me if you think I have been negative. But I want to be positive as I close. Time is a gift of God to you and me. And every gift God has given to us, we will be accountable to Him. Psalm 31, verse 14 and 15. My days are in your hands. My time is in your hand. So your time is your life. Please think about it when you leave tonight. Time is short. Bear in mind its brevity. So how can a Christian redeem the time? I want to give you, as I close, some guidelines. Please, this is not moralization or to moralize anyone. There are thousands of books written about managing the time. But these are very simple guidelines to help us, according to the Word of God. How can I redeem? Practical. in a practical way, how can I redeem the time? So I will not give you tell you how many I have, but I will see my time is almost over. So the first one, how to redeem the time. To redeem the time, we have to be inconveniencing ourselves. If it's not an English word, choose a better one. We have to inconvenience ourselves, which means that a sacrifice is required if you want to redeem the time. What do I mean by inconveniencing myself? It means I have to leave something good for something better. That's the first. By the way, it's not by order of importance. The second one, the second help I have, or to redeem the time, you have to put off the old man. Kill the old man. Suffocate him. Strangle him if it's required. So put off the old man. Abhor what is evil. Paul says in Romans 12, verse 9. Time spent feeding sin is destructive. You know, why do we fall in sin? Because sin is sin. It's in us. There is a magnet in us. That's why Satan, we fall into Satan's hand. Because there is that magnet in us. Otherwise, we wouldn't fall into sin. So we put on, we resist the devil. We remain humble, sober, serious, sound, vigilant. Never put confidence in the flesh. Abstain from fleshly lusts. The way we use our time will tell how close we are to the Lord. The third one, a balanced Christian life between work, church, and family. Please be balanced. I have people, they said, oh, we said in this church, neglect your family for the work of the Lord. We have never said that. We said, don't be disproportionate. It's not all family, family. It's not all work, work. It's not all service, service. Be balanced. That's what the Bible says. And that's what the Bible says. Don't neglect your family. The Lord, you will be accountable before the Lord. Don't neglect the service of the Lord. Toil, labor, knowing that your labor will not be in vain in the Lord. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58. It will not be in vain in the Lord. If you are doing it for the Lord, it will not be in vain. So, a balanced Christian life, because only what we do for the Lord, this world is going to pass by. 1 John 2, 17. Only what we do for the Lord will remain. And who does the will of God is eternal. So we are not give ourselves our work to the neglect of our family. The fourth one, seek to understand the will of God. How do we know the will of God? Romans 12, verse 1 and 2. That's there to know the will of God. Do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewal of the mind. So you will know the will of God. It's here in verse 17, Ephesians 5, 17. We are to know the will of God and walk in the will of God. So make every decision according to the word of God. His will is that sinners are being saved. The fifth one, plan your time. Think ahead of time. Think forward. It's very important. Distinguish between the urgent and the important. Do the right thing at the right time. I often say, don't read good books. Oh, I'm in trouble. Read only the best. Why? Because time is short. So read good books, but read the best. Because time is short. Your days and my days are counted. And sixth one, do good to other people. That's the purpose. You are saved. Galatians 6, verse 10. While you still have time, the opportunity again, it's there. While you still have time, do good to other people, especially to all men, but especially those of the household, the Christians. So a Christian is someone who does good works. Hebrews 13, verse 16, verse 21. A Christian does good works. Ephesians 2, verse 10. We are saved to do good works. James, the letter of James is all about this. The body without soul is dead. The faith without work is also dead. So we have all the teaching, the instruction in the Word of God about how to do good to other people. Befriend the lonely and those who are at the fringe in the church. Someone may need to be shown love and care. So we are there for him. Please, I know you have me saying this many times. People are important, not projects and possessions. We love people. We want to see people coming to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. The seventh one, constantly and always asking yourself, what does God want me to do? When Paul was saved in Acts chapter 9, that's his first question. What do you want me to do, Lord? Today, tomorrow, next week, next year, what do you want me to do? The eighth one, self-discipline, self-restraint, self-control. Do not be imbibed, but be sober. You know, Luther, he said, there are only 2 days on my calendar. Today, this day, and that day. Only 2 days. So he knew what it means to redeem the time. Today, Bible says, is the day of salvation. Salvation is only in the span of time. Now is the favorable time to repent and to be saved. The ninth one, seek to serve the Lord on every opportunity. Every occasion given to you. Secure every moment for the Lord. Remove the obstacles that will prevent you from serving the Lord, from attending the services, from prayer, from reading the scriptures, from witnessing. Remove the obstacles. Resist the devil, Bible says, and he shall flee from you. And repent from the time wasted. Lay up your treasures in the right place. We are not to live just to enjoy the here and now. Live today in the light of tomorrow, heaven. Finally, check your motives. Evaluate your actions daily. What you are supposed to do for the Lord. What do you spend your time most on? My dear brothers and sisters, may the Lord give us many, many opportunities. Every opportunity counts. May he give us many opportunities, great opportunities, to buy up the time and help us to make the best use of each opportunity for his glory. Redeem the time, for the days are evil. Let's close by singing our last hymn, hymn number 608. Hymn number 608. When this passing world is done, when I stand yon radiant sun, when I stand with Christ on high, looking over life history. Heavenly Father, we pray that the expression of these words will be the desire of the heart of each one of us. O Lord, we thank Thee that Thou art with us. Left to ourselves, we will never be able to do these things. But again, Lord, we cry for Thy help, that Thou will deepen us in our most holy faith, that we will be children of light, walking as children of light, redeeming the time, and seizing, taking every occasion, every opportunity to show the love of Christ for sinners. O Lord, accompany us, be with us, Lord. We pray that none of us will bring shame to the testimony, but we will stand boldly to witness with great kindness and love and compassion to those who have not yet come to Thee. Lord, protect us against the enemy of our souls, and we pray that Thou will forgive us again all our sins and trespasses. Bless every one of us. We are so dependent. Fill us with the power of the Holy Spirit. Bless our families, Lord. Bless every member, every visitor among us, Lord. O Lord, protect us again. We pray that Christ will continue to be glorified in the life of each one of us. We pray and ask all these things in His name and for His glory. Amen.
Amen.